This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Akbar, Emperor of India. Author: Richard von Garbe. Topic: Akbar, Emperor of India. The student of India, who would at the same time be an historian, discovers to his sorrow that the land of his researches is lamentably poor in historical sources. And if, within the realm of historical investigation, a more seductive charm lies for him in the analysis of great personalities than in ascertaining the course of historical development, then verily may he look about in vain for such personalities in the antiquity and Middle Ages of India. Not that the princely thrones were wanting in great men in ancient India, for we find abundant traces of them in Hindu folklore and poetry, but these sources do not extend to establishing the realistic element in details and furnishing life like portraits of the men themselves. That the Hindu has ever been but little interested in historical matters is a generally recognized fact. Religious and philosophical speculations, dreams of other worlds, of previous and future existences, have claimed the attention of thoughtful minds to a much greater degree than has historical reality. The misty myth-woven veil which hangs over persons and events of earlier times vanishes at the beginning of the modern era, which in India starts with the Mohammedan conquest, for henceforth the history of India is written by foreigners. Now we meet with men who take a decisive part in the fate of India, and they appear as sharply outlined, even though generally unpleasing, personalities. Islam has justly been characterized as the caricature of a religion. Fanaticism and fatalism are two conspicuously irreligious emotions, and it is exactly these two emotions which Islam understands how to arouse in savage peoples, to which it owes the part it has played in the history of the world, and the almost unprecedented success of its diffusion in Asia, Africa, and Europe. About 1000 AD, India was invaded by the Sultan Mahmud of Ghazni. With Mahmud's expedition into India begins one of the most horrible periods of the history of Hindustan. One monarch dethrones another, no dynasty continues in power, every accession to the throne is accompanied by the murder of kinsmen, plundering of cities, devastation of the lowlands, and the slaughter of thousands of men, women, and children of the predecessor's adherents. For 5 centuries, northwest and northern India literally reeked with the blood of multitudes. Mohammedan dynasties of Afghan, Turkish, and Mongolian origin follow that of Ghazni. This entire period is filled with an almost boundless series of battles, intrigues, imbroglios, and political revolutions. Nearly all events had the one characteristic in common, that they took place amid murder, pillage, and fire. Akbar, Emperor of India. From Noor's Kaiser Akbar, Frontispiece to Volume 2. The most frightful spectacle throughout these reeking centuries is the terrible Mongolian prince Timur, a successor of Genghis Khan, who fell upon India with his band of assassins in the year 1398, and before his entry into Delhi, the capital, in which he was proclaimed Emperor of India, caused the 100,000 prisoners whom he had captured in his previous battles in the Punjab to be slaughtered in one single day because it was too inconvenient to drag them around with him. So says Timur himself with shameless frankness in his account of the expedition, and he further relates that after his entry into Delhi, all 3 districts of the city were plundered according to the will of God. In 1526, Babur, a descendant of Timur, made his entry into Delhi and there founded the dominion of the Grand Mughals, i.e., of the Great Mongols. The overthrow of this dynasty was brought about by the disastrous reign of Babur's successor Aurangzeb, a cruel, crafty, and treacherous despot, who, following the example of his ancestor Timur, spread terror and alarm around him in the second half of the 17th and the beginning of the 18th centuries. Even today, Hindus may be seen to tremble when they meet the sinister fanatical glance of a Mohammedan. Princes with sympathetic qualities were not entirely lacking in the 7 centuries of Mohammedan dominion in India, and they shine forth as points of light from the gloomy horror of this time, but they fade out completely before the luminous picture of the man who governed India for half a century, 1556 to 1605, and by a wise, gentle, and just reign, brought about a season of prosperity such as the land had never experienced in the millenniums of its history. This man, whose memory even today is revered by the Hindus, was a descendant of Babur, Abul Fath Jalaluddin Muhammad, known by the surname Akbar the Great, which was conferred upon the child even when he was named, and completely supplanted the name that properly belonged to him. And truly he justified the epithet, for great, fabulously great, was Akbar as man, general, statesman, and ruler, all in all a prince who deserves to be known by everyone whose heart is moved by the spectacle of true human greatness. When we wish to understand a personality, we are in the habit of ascertaining the inherited characteristics and investigating the influences exercised upon it by religion, family, environment, education, youthful impressions, experience, and so forth. Most men are easily comprehensible as the products of these factors. The more independent of all such influences, or the more in opposition to them, a personality develops, the more attractive and interesting will it appear to us. At the first glance, it looks as if the Emperor Akbar had developed his entire character from himself, and by his own efforts, in total independence of all influences, which in other cases are thought to determine the character and nature of a man. A Mohammedan, a Mongol, a descendant of the monster Timur, the son of a weak, incapable father, born in exile, called when but a lad to the government of a disintegrated and almost annihilated realm in the India of the 16th century, which means in an age of perfidy, treachery, avarice, and self-seeking, Akbar appears before us as a noble man, susceptible to all grand and beautiful impressions, conscientious, unprejudiced, and energetic, who knew how to bring peace and order out of the confusion of the times, who throughout his reign desired the furtherance of his subjects and not of his own interest, who while increasing the privileges of the Mohammedans, not only also declared equality of rights for the Hindus, but even actualized that equality, who in every conceivable way sought to conciliate his subjects so widely at variance with each other in race, customs, and religion, and who finally, when the narrow dogmas of his religion no longer satisfied him, attained to a purified faith in God, which was independent of all formulated religions. A closer observation, however, shows that the contrast is not quite so harsh between what, according to our hypotheses, Akbar should have been as a result of the forces which build up man, and what he actually became. His predilection for science and art, Akbar, had inherited from his grandfather Babur and his father Humayun.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.